Throw that in my backpack, please.
Put this one safe, and I'm gonna sit at the top.
I love how they preserved all the ancient lighting.
That ancient lighting.
I like all the paw prints in the stone. That's what I like.
Yeah.
Everybody, welcome to Caesarea Maritime.
Yes.
Okay. We are at Caesarea Maritime, the ruins of Caesarea Maritime. I'm actually sitting in the theater of it right now. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the theater because we had a theater at Medshan, but I think this is a good starting point because of the location of this theater in relationship to the city, in addition to what the heartbeat of the theater was in relationship to Herod, why we had a theater in the first place. Okay. So, we're obviously sitting on the shore of the Mediterranean Sea, which is right behind that backdrop. That backdrop isn't always there, so you can see the sea. It's up today, so we got a block of view, but we'll get a good view later on as far as the Mediterranean Sea goes. Okay, but we got the Mediterranean Sea. So the structure of the theater is set up in a way so the prevailing winds help with the acoustics.
Wow.
So that's why they did it in the way that they did.
Wow.
So that you had, so you've got the wind coming in and just obviously helps with the acoustics of the entire scene of the thing. Now we're about 60 miles northwest of Jerusalem here. Okay? The entirety of this city was built by Herod the Great. So Herod the Great built this whole city, and it was completed about 10 BC. Now this city was in addition to many other building projects that he had, including the Herodian, which is just outside of Bethlehem. We talked about Masada, which is on the Dead Sea, okay? As well as Jericho and some others. He had major, massive building projects all throughout the nation, obviously including the Temple Mount, the reconstruction of the Temple Mount, the expansion of the Temple Mount. Now all these projects cost a lot of money. Since they cost so much money, he needed to have some kind of revenue to be able to continue to sustain such large projects. This city was built for that reason. It was built for two reasons, and one of them was for finances, because there was no port city in Israel. So he built a port city, thus cutting off Alexandria in Egypt from trade, because now they could come in through Israel and have access onto Jordan and to Saudi Arabia. It was like the perfect location for a port city to exist. Okay? But to have a port city, you had to do some pretty massive projects to accomplish the ability to have ships here. And yeah. I mean, you had to have a port to have a port city. We'll examine the port here just a little bit. Now, the other reason why the city was built was because The way that Josephus talks about it is it's the furthest way that you can get from Jerusalem and while being close to Rome. So he went as far away from Jerusalem as he could to get as close to Rome as he could, for the sole purpose of gaining favor with Rome and the power of Rome, okay? And also, in addition to that, that meant the heartbeat of the city revolved around Roman culture, Greco-Roman culture. And as we saw at Tatian, one of the heartbeats, one of the main heartbeats of Greco-Roman culture was the entertainment industry. Now, this theater is built outside the city gates. It's actually outside the city, and the reason why is because there wasn't Jewish population that was here at the time of Herod the Great, after its construction. And because of the kind of content that was at this theater, how offensive it would have been, he built it outside the city. It was a very risque type of theater as far as the kinds of plays that were done here, okay? And so he built it outside the city because it would have been so offensive to so many Jews that were actually dwelling and living within the city as a whole. Now the entire city was covered with white marble. There was a bunch of different kinds of marble, but the whole city was covered with white marble, okay? And it said that if you actually were coming in from the ocean, a day like this, the whole entire city glistened like a bright pearl. But you could see it just pop because of all the reflection. So bright, so white, okay, when they were coming ashore, all right? So it was a very, very Herodian, the great city. Great, and it's all right because Herod wanted to make it great in his own way. Okay, so at the seaport, as I said, I made the statement, but it connects you to Persia, Babylonia, the Orient, the Arabian Peninsula. It was very strategic as far as its location goes because it was the only existing one outside of, as far as in the Middle East goes. He also, in addition to all this, wanted to propagate Hellenistic culture. Wanted to propagate Hellenism in the land, and this was one of the easiest ways for him to be able to do that was to create a city that was bustling around this topic and that would cause people to want to come and obviously be a part of it. And so to this day, anybody who's got money lives in Caesarea. So Netanyahu, all the homes are here, this is the place. Okay, so I mean to this day, Amitai and I were having a conversation, so many things, you know, it goes around, comes around, it's a recycling of things. So this day, this place, it's always been kind of having this feel of prominence. This is where you come, it's on the ocean, if you got money, this is where you want to be, prominence, those types of things. So, so the port obviously made way to the port was actually, it was finished in 10 BC with the city, but it began in 22 BC. So we're talking about a 12-year period that this thing was able to be built. So, it's a very short period of time, and the reason why so many of these projects were built in such a short period of time, and the reason why was because he had the money to do it. Now, it's different than the Temple Mount. The Temple Mount, actually, it ended up taking about 45 to 50 years to complete because the only individuals that could work on it had to be of priestly lineage. And so the only ones that could do work on the temple, so it was kind of in a different category. We'll examine that whenever we're actually in Jerusalem at the temple. But he was able to Now, obviously, it was destroyed by the Romans, okay, not obviously, but it was destroyed by the Romans in 70 AD, and they basically took the thing and they bulldozed it into the city, into the sea, okay? And so it was all destroyed as a result of the Romans coming through. At one point, it was 9 stories from the water into the city, so it sat up high. So it was 9 stories elevated, so you could see it, obviously, from the sea because it was elevated from sea level quite some capacity. Caesar Augustus, what does Augustus mean?
Updated.
Venerable one.
The venerable one.
So Caesar Augustus came for its dedication in 10 BC, okay? And in this theater, they actually found a stone, okay, that's got Pontius Pilate's name engraved on it, okay? Pontius Pilate, this would have been a seat of his. The city was a seat for governors and tetrarchs, and so he had his name engraved on a stone, and it was found in this theater, most likely as a location where he would have sat when he came to the theater. Okay, so this was that was the kind of situation, the kind of people this place attracted. Now, real quickly, just a couple of biblical events before I take any comments or questions. So after baptizing an Ethiopian eunuch, Philip was transported to Ashkelon, and then he ended up coming here to evangelize. We get that in Acts chapter 8. Paul obviously sailed all throughout the ancient world, and this, if he was going to sail from Israel, this is the place he would have sailed from, okay? So this was the port to access up north and to get out, and to actually get out of Israel. Cornelius, the first Gentile to be saved, so to speak, was in Acts chapter 10, lived here. This is where Peter came and preached the gospel to Cornelius, was here in Caesarea. Paul's missionary journey is obviously began here. It said that Philip the evangelist, okay, different than the Philip that we get in the preaching gospel to the Ethiopian eunuch, Philip the evangelist and his four daughters lived here before they ended up moving up to Hierapolis.
Go ahead. Sorry.
No, you're fine. Brings a whole new meaning to the term. They don't build it like they used to.
Some things are still standing.
Shoot, most anything that was built back in the 1920s, 1930s in America, it's long since fallen. I can't imagine the engineering feat that would have been to build all this.
Again, please.
I can see how it would just completely confound engineers today. How in the world the engineering feat that it would have taken to build this, especially all out of white marble.
We're gonna go in, please. Don't lose the group.
Especially not because they're taking pictures. Yeah, it is. Yeah, that really is. Like, it's how pretty the water is, the rocks, the tires are fine.
Need coffee. Yeah.
Because in my mind, it's like, what time would be home? 8 hours.
8 hours behind. What is it here?
3:19.
Oh, shoot, 8 hours. You're looking at 7 o'clock?
Yeah, it's 7 o'clock at home. So
yeah.
In the morning.
Almost reminds me of Fairhope.
Okay, so I want to talk about the harbor that's here, okay?
I'm not sure where it is now.
I don't know.
You'll be in the bar park either way.
Comments, questions. Probably where, hey Ellie, that grassy area where dignitaries would have sat.
Are you talking about this or?
No, right up the grass area.
Yeah. Oh, no, this is a later building from the Byzantine period.
What's when, Byzantine?
Yeah, when they stopped doing the horse racing.
Closed it.
Yeah.
Yeah, closed
up.
Okay, so they're saying the Byzantines came in here and made it smaller. Made it more of an amphitheater type of thing.
Maybe like a stage.
Any other questions? Okay, come friends.
He single-handedly.
The whole thing.
Yeah. They built, of course, the Jordan brand is its own.
Yeah, its own deal.
Its own deal altogether. But he was the first athlete to basically globalize a brand and trademark and make the creator of
How you doing, Toby?
Well, you just with that, you just have got it going all the time.
All the time. As much as the battery will let me. I do stop it and I turn it off and everything. I haven't captured everything, but I want to capture as much as I can.
Sure.
Especially the teachings that go along with it.
Yeah.
Back on the show, the Bible study Thursday night, I'm going to kind of whittle everything down. Show them some of the main highlights, but I want to make sure I keep all this. All this video and all this footage.
Is there a way to send that to somebody on email?
Oh, I can email it.
I wish you'd email it to us. Is that called something?
Not at all.
I wish you could, would you?
I would. If I get somebody's email,
huh?
I can break this up into probably even smaller segments. Say yeah, like day one, yeah, day two.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Shoot, I could even have Bryce. Bryce does a lot of video editing. So what we could probably do there is I could even have Bryce
then I could
whittle everything down into like sites day one, sites day two. Not all this, you know, kind of walking in between. The reason I want to do this is because I want to take my family and everybody the Bible study basically on the same journey I went on.
I didn't think you were married.
I'm not.
Oh, you mean your
my grandparents.
Yeah, that'd be
my grandparents
great.
And
but if you could send that to me, that would be just awesome.
I wouldn't.
Then I could show my wife and
oh, absolutely.
Kind of what all we did. Just the edited part.
Yeah, I'll have Bryce kind of go through. We'll have to go through all the footage and we'll edit everything down. We'll kind of whittle it down to the main sites. Now there's one, like the amount of Beatitudes.
Right.
I mainly just took a few pictures, but I wanted to really pay attention to the teaching on that one. Good yeah. Lord. Just the sheer amount of white marble they used.
It's
phenomenal.
So,
So what we see before us here, okay, is an aqueduct. All right.
What does it mean?
Great question. Aqua. Wonder. So this is an aqueduct. Now, Avital and I were actually in a discussion earlier, and clearly there is some contradicting views on what's going on here. So, but either way, I'll tell you where I stand, and I'll tell you where Avital, what he's learned as well. And so, I like mine better. I'm just kidding. But it's but anyway. So what it is Herod the Great, because of the amount of water that was needed to sustain the city, built two massive aqueducts that are 16 miles long that come from Mount Carmel. And the gradient on them follows just enough so the water is able to be at a downward approach the entire time, but not too much to move too fast. All the way from 60 miles away, coming all the way into the city. Okay?
Hello.
Obviously, swimming pool, fresh water, they have fountains. I mean, we're talking, you know, for a pretty extravagant ordeal, a pretty extravagant profit process. Okay? Now, on top of this is a channel, all right? The channel, all right, is 30 inches deep and 16 inches wide. Okay? It's about the size of it, all right? But there were two of these things. Now, what Amitai learned is that this was actually built underneath the Byzantines, which would have been about 350 to 400 years later, after the time of Herod the Great, after his death. So Herod the Great died in 4 BC, and so the Byzantine Empire began to arise and come along and then strengthened up 400 AD. After that, around 400 to 600 AD. So what I've studied, what I've learned, is that this is Herodian in construction. What he studied, what he learned, is that this is Byzantine construction. So, do your homework. We don't know. Figure it out on your own. But there's some studies that might be a little material for you. All right. So, yes.
Do we have any idea how they measured the angle? Because I know it's pretty precise.
Very precise.
No. How does what is the instrument that they use? The
series
trigonometry. How do they do that?
I don't know what instruments they use. And when you see what Herod the Great built, he had the best people on the job.
It's standing here, but you found it.
Yeah, still standing. Still standing. Yeah, it's pretty impressive. Yeah. So I want you guys to see this, so you can actually see an aqueduct. Yes.
Can you kind of tell by the design?
Alright, climbing up in to an ancient Roman aqueduct. We got about 2 minutes.
Time to go, guys.
Time to go.
Oh, excuse me, I'm cutting in front of you. Excuse me, George.